Incredible ocean, magical place to be. So much that we can learn from life in the deep blue sea. Incredible ocean, magical place to be. So much that we can learn from life in the deep blue sea.
Good morning! Oh, happy World Ocean Day!
This is the best day of the year! This is like our Christmas! What awesome day! Just about the ocean! Yeah. And I personally feel that every day we should be like, yeah, the ocean! Which I do in my heart. I do in my heart. But this is where we get to do it officially.
Yeah!
Did you get that? Officially. Well, it's World Ocean Day for schools, which this is what we're part of. And there's a fantastic lineup over on the World Ocean Day for Schools. There's stuff going on all day for all ages, for people who are into all kinds of things, all themed around the ocean. So definitely go to worldoceanday.school, which is a website. So so people probably don't know too much about us. We're Incredible Oceans and we're here and our mission is to try and make the teach everyone about how cool our ocean is. And we do this by combining science and art and fun and music and all of these cool things together. So people know who we are a little bit. Let's do a quick introduction, shall we? So Annette, go!
So, hello. So, I am a marine biologist and a performer and an artist. And I make stuff about the sea. I love sea creatures and obviously everything in the ocean. I love making, painting, puppets, all kinds of things. All to show people just how great life in our ocean is.
Oh. And Abby, what do you do?
Hello. So, I love focusing on all the beautiful things that our ocean and all the animals that actually need the ocean, which is all of us. Working to sort of conserve them, sort of working together. I love working with people and communities to sort of just make sure that the ocean stays or can remain beautiful.
Oh, good work. Everyone needs people like that as well. And my name's Russell, and I am what's called an oceanographer. And when I tell people that I'm an oceanographer, everyone goes, is that someone that takes photos of the ocean? Because they think it's like an ocean photographer. But actually what an oceanographer is someone who studies the water, the actual water itself. So whereas Annette is a marine biologist, there's Annette, Annette's over there. She studies the animals in it. I study the water itself. And in particular, I really like the tiny little plankton that float around in the water. And that's what I study. So today we have got a lot of fun going on and we try and do lots of these shows. So what everyone has to do after this show or even during this show is to go to YouTube, our YouTube channel, which is if you just type in Incredible Oceans and you click subscribe. Totally subscribe to our YouTube channel and then you'll get lots more really cool fun videos from us all about the ocean. So let's kick off today's World Ocean Day special.
I was just going to thank everyone because we're already getting lots of lovely questions in the chat. So thank you so much. We're going to do a Q&A at the end, so we'll answer them then. So we are seeing your questions and we're excited about them.
Awesome. Keep them coming in. We like to be tested. We like to be tested. Cool. So we've got three really quick little videos we're going to show you and we're going to talk about, because just so you get like a bit of a flavor of what Incredible Oceans TV is about. So I believe we're kicking off with Annette. Go.
Yeah. So today, guys, I've got a totally awesome video for you. Yay. So enjoy it. Yay.
Hello and welcome to Incredible Oceans Art. So today we're going to be learning all about sea turtles, and there are 7 different species of sea turtle that we have alive today.
Blackback turtle, green turtle, hawksbill turtle, long-haired turtle, pen-friendly turtle, olive-friendly turtle, leatherback.
Gosh, there we go.
So for those of you that missed that, that is the flatback turtle who you'll find in the waters of Australia. This, the green sea turtle, who is one of the largest and also our only herbivore. Hawksbill sea turtle, who's critically endangered and sadly prized for their shells. The Kemp's Ridley sea turtle, who is our rarest and smallest. The loggerhead turtle, who's named for its exceptionally large head. The olive Ridley sea turtle, who is the most abundant of all our species. And finally, the leatherback, who we're looking at today. Now, these wonderful creatures may be small when they hatch, but they get big. These record breakers are the biggest sea turtles in the world, reaching 6 feet. And they are the fastest. They've been known to swim over 20 miles an hour in search of their prey, the jellyfish. And to help them catch their slippery prey, they have a mouth full of papillae, which hook them in. Now this turtle might look like it's crying, but it's actually releasing salt. There's so much salt in jellyfish that these guys have salt glands twice the size of their brains. Now let's make it. So start off by drawing out your leatherback. Now I'm going to actually paint mine first this week and then cut it out. So you may have noticed that the shell of a leatherback is different to other sea turtles, and that's because they deep dive to over 1,000 meters, so they need to be able to collapse their lungs. Because on all sea turtles, their shell, the top, the carapace, is knitted to their ribs through bony plates, they need to have special adaptations to be able to do this. So instead of the keratin solid scutes that most sea turtles have, instead, over the top of their carapace, they have a thick layer of waxy, oily skin, lots of blubber, and instead of those big hard plates, they have little bones which all fit throughout the carapace to make it flexible. Wow. Now you can see that I'm using lots of greys and blacks and white, and that's because these turtles are dark color so that they can retain heat more easily. They also have a thick layer of blubber. Now, once you've finished with your sea creature, it's time for your leatherback to go into your biome. Wonderful.
Aww. Beautiful. Thanks for that.
Oh, you're so welcome. I do love turtles.
Oh, they are just beautiful, aren't they? Magnificent. And so majestic.
They are. Majestic is the word. And thank you so much. We're getting so many questions and we are so excited, guys. So keep them coming in. Wonderful stuff.
Brilliant. And you're telling us where you're from. This is great. Yeah, keep it coming in.
Yeah, we're so excited to speak to you all.
Yeah. All right. Well, moving on to an animal which is utterly amazing.
I see what you did there.
And there might be, so they're a top predator, but they might not be an animal that you necessarily relate to the ocean, but they are a very good indication of a healthy marine life. So I will, any questions that you have, keep them, but type them in the comments and we will answer them at the end.
We will. And then before we show the next video, if you like what we're doing, please donate because it helps us make educational videos so that we can keep telling you just how cool the ocean is. Thank you. Let's go.
Let's go.
What's so special about otters? Is it that they're a top predator or that they're beautifully engineered to be brilliant both above and below the water? Well, following their decline in the 1950s, the otter seems to have made a welcome comeback to many UK rivers and waterways, so it's now possible for any of us to see otters in the wild. Coasts and rivers are a great place to see otters, and I live near the River Usk. Why are otters so special? I'm going to find out.
Morning, guys. Hello, that's better. So it's 4:35 here. I have come down to the river where there's been a few sightings of a family of otters. I'm just going to sit really quietly for a bit of time and see what happens.
Oh, that's much better. It's a bit brighter and I have had a cup of coffee. So we are on the lookout for the Eurasian otter. There are 13 species of otter in total. The Eurasian can be found all throughout Europe, parts of Asia, and even as far as Africa. Otters are shy, so there's a very good chance that any otter on this part of the river already knows I'm here. So my plan is to walk further down the river, set up camp, be quiet, have another cup of coffee, and hopefully we'll see something.
In this river, you've got wild salmon and trout. And that's, there we go. And fish makes up quite a bit of an otter's diet.
Otter tracks are distinguishable by the amount of toes that they have. So they've got five. So you've got the larger pad here, and you've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There aren't any otters that I can see.
One of the threats that conservationists are increasingly worried about. Because we know otters spend most of their time in the water. So any water that's contaminated is going to affect their skin, it's going to irritate their eyes. They also eat fish and they eat other animals from the water. So they're going to be eating contaminated food. So I spoke to Dave Webb from the UK Otter Trust, and he tells me that road traffic accidents are actually one of the biggest killers of our otters. They kill thousands of otters a year. There's a solution though, and they are trying to work with councils to build under road tunnels, which means that wildlife can pass without actually venturing on the road. I'm going to be writing a letter to my local MP to apply even more pressure for them to think about wildlife and inserting these tunnels in any new developments. And even better, you can actually become a young otter ambassador. The UK Otter Trust are looking for young people to get involved in their projects and become ambassadors. And there's loads more information and fun facts all about otters on their websites.
I have absolutely loved trying to find otters, and to have otters living wild in the UK and for their numbers to eventually be rising is incredible. Aww.
Oh, otters! They're so cute! I love them!
They are cute, and they bring like peace and restore balance to our waterways. So they are cute, but they're also very important.
Well, so the thing that I actually, I'm sorry, everyone watching, I hate cute animals. I hate them. And everyone's like, you can't hate the cute animals. But the problem is that all the animals on the planet are important. And we come along and we say, that ugly animal, I don't like that animal, so I don't want to save that one. But that one's cute, so I want to save that. And it's not fair, because even if you're an ugly animal, you're still important to the planet. Yeah. So everyone's like, I like cute things. Well, I like the ugly things. So what I did is I decided, everyone was talking to me about how cute penguins were. So I thought, I'm going to do a silly penguin video. So I have a really bad penguin joke, which I'm going to show you now. I'm sorry, it's an awful joke. But it's quite clever. It's quite clever as well. Ooh, clever joke.
A clever joke. What's your joke?
Well, you need to press play to show you the awful joke. This is the worst penguin. Oi, mate, do you know why polar bears don't eat penguins?
It's because the two species are geographically separated. Polar bears live in the North Pole, while penguins are exclusive to the Southern Hemisphere.
Nah, it's because they can't undo the wrappers with their paws.
Here's what I think of that joke.
It's 10:30 in the morning and you've seen a penguin poo on another penguin! Ha ha ha! Penguins poo on another penguin! Ha ha ha! Everyone, and I know at the end everyone's gonna be like, so is the penguin pooing again? It's so funny! There we go. So like I said, I am an oceanographer, as well as not liking cute animals. I'm quite interested in about what it's like to explore underwater. Now, the funny thing is, right, everyone, when I go into schools and I talk to people, I always say, what do you want to do when you grow up? And they're always like, I want to be an astronaut. I want to go to astronaut place, into space. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And I'm like, well, did you know that we've sent over 500 astronauts up there? 500 astronauts, but only 4 people have been to the bottom of the deepest part of our ocean. And I was like, why is this? Why don't we send many people down? Why is it so dangerous to go deep down into the ocean? So I go snorkeling and I go swimming in the sea all the time and I love it. But why is it so difficult to go deep down underwater? So I did some research into what it's like to be a diver and what it's like to be in a submarine. So this might be a bit like, oh, but we'll be all right. So let's roll this. We're gonna find out why it's dangerous to go deep underwater. Hello, it's me, Russell, and I'm pretending to be a French explorer underwater. Not too dissimilar to Jacques Cousteau, maybe. Who knows? Apologies to all of our French viewers out there. Going underwater can be dangerous. While it's possible to drown in just a few centimeters of water, the ocean depths present us with an entirely new set of dangers to be wary of. Since the days of ancient Greece, people have longed to visit the underwater realm. While early attempts were constrained by how long you could hold your breath for, by the Victorian era, we had started to develop ever more elaborate contraptions to help us access the deep. The first heavy footer dive suit was made in 1819 by a German called August Sieb. These early suits used weighted boots to allow the diver to sink to depths of up to 160 meters while a hose tethered them to a pump on the surface. Too frequently, the surface pumps would fail, but before the unfortunate diver succumbed to a lack of oxygen, a much worse fate awaited them. You see, the surface pump not only provided the diver with air, but also equalized the pressure at depth. Without the air pressure from the pump to keep the water at bay, the diver's body was at the mercy of the crushing depths. As a human body is more compressible than steel, the diver's entire body would be forced up into their helmet. When Jacques Cousteau and Émile Gagnon invented the self-contained underwater breathing apparatus, or scuba, they ushered in a new era of untethered diving. But pressure is still an issue. As scuba divers breathe pressurized air, gases are forced into the diver's blood, much like carbon dioxide being forced into a fizzy drink. If the diver then surfaces too quickly, these gases depressurize rapidly until bubbles start forming in the diver's tissue, resulting in a painful and sometimes fatal condition called the bends. In 1960, Swiss oceanographer Jacques Picard and Don Walsh, a lieutenant in the US Navy, made history when they piloted the Trieste Bathyscape down to almost 11,000 meters into the Mariana Trench. At that depth, there was the equivalent of an entire hippopotamus pressing down on every square centimeter of the bathyscape. If the Trieste had been unlucky and got a leak at 11,000 meters, seawater would have started to spray in. But the jet of water would have been so pressurized at that depth that it would have cut through the men like a laser through butter. And if the Trieste had completely imploded under the pressure, Picard and Walsh would have been crushed into a human smoothie in less than a second. Gross. Visiting the Mariana Trench is so dangerous that only four people have made the journey. Compare that to 550 astronauts that have been up into space, and you start to wonder, which is the harshest environment? Outer space or the bottom of the ocean? Can you see my nipples in this? Are my nipples too far out?
Couldn't resist, could you?
Sorry about that. Sorry. You're like, what? Who is this man? He showed us a penguin pooping on us. And now, basically, it was quite cold. And I've borrowed another top that isn't normally my top. So I was a bit worried that it was my nipples were a bit prominent. But they're okay. Anyway, right. We've had so many questions coming in. This is crazy. And they're really good questions. So we're going to do our best to quickly answer all these questions. This is amazing.
I'm going to just fire up. We're going to go from the beginning, right?
Let's go for it. Super quick. Let's do these questions.
Okay. So, quick one. Why do we have Ocean Day? From Florence. Thanks, Florence.
Why do we have Ocean Day? Well, every day should be Ocean Day, but it's because now people are realizing how important our ocean is. Not many people know this, but everyone's like, the trees keep us alive by making oxygen. Actually, 80% of the oxygen that we breathe comes from the sea. And everyone's like, what? What? So that's one reason that we need to celebrate and look after our ocean. But also, I like eating fish and chips, and I know lots of people do. So it's important that we look after our fish stocks, and we take, when we catch fish, we do it in a clever way to make sure that there's fish left over for everyone else and all the animals. So we don't take too much.
Yes, respect, my friend. Okay, lovely answer. How does the leatherback turtle eat jellyfish?
So they do it really, really, really well. So if you think of a jellyfish, it's really slippery, right? And like soft. So they've got beaks that they use to catch them, first of all. And then they've got all of those spikes inside their throat, which stops the jellyfish from slipping back out. So it kind of hooks them right down, and it keeps them. It goes all the way down their, like their esophagus, all the way down to their stomach. It's got those special chitinous spikes, and that holds the jellyfish inside so it can't slither back out again. And they're also, they've got really thick scales on their faces so that they don't get stung by the jellyfish as well.
I was once stung on the face by a jellyfish, and it was not fun. I wasn't trying to eat. I was looking at it too closely through my goggles, and then it stung me, which was silly of me. But yeah, because I wasn't trying to eat it. Don't worry. Anyway, next
and
question.
And you made a full recovery. Okay, next question. Can we find otters in North Wales, and what is the best way to spot one? You absolutely can. So you can find them both on the coast and in your waterways. So if you're near a river or a or like in a canal. what I'll do is in the link or the video description, I'm going to post a link to the UK Wild Otter Trust. And in there, they've got loads of tips on how best to find them, what time of day, what signs to look for. You can sort of look for tracks and sprint, which is sort of poop, otter poop. So take a look at that. And you can also have a look at the areas where they are most commonly seen too. So they try to do an otter survey approximately every 8 to 10 years. So it just gives you a good idea of where you might find one. But you absolutely can find them, and I would definitely recommend you go looking for them.
Yeah. What's the name for otter poo?
Sprint.
Sprint. That's a new sprint. Word that I've learned today.
No, it's sprint. And good, do you know word. What? It actually smells quite nice. It smells a bit like popcorn.
Oh, there you go. I never knew
otter, that. Now that is a fact. Yeah, there you go. That's what I've learned today on World Ocean Day. Otter poo smells like popcorn. Yes.
There you go. And we do have sea otters and river otters as well.
Yes, we do. So, and this answers Beverly's question about oceans. Yet you do find otters in the ocean and in the rivers. So there is a slight difference between the two, but you can find them in both.
I've got to say, sea otters that live along the coast of California are massive. Some of them are like 2 meters long. And when I went there, they, like, 2 meters long is like as big as a man. I was like, is that a man in a onesie floating in the sea? And they were like, no, that's a sea otter. They are literally 2 meters long, like a massive dog. So yeah, there you go.
Wow. Okay, so from Michaela, how many animals are there in the ocean?
Wow, this, Michaela, is an awesome question. Now, this is a really important question, because the problem at the moment is we need more people to be marine scientists to figure this out, because we have only explored 5% of the ocean. And so at the moment, we find a new creature that no one has ever seen before. We find one every 2 weeks. So there's so much of our ocean that we still need to explore that we just don't know what's there. So we need people like you, Mia, to come along and be like, I'm going to be a marine scientist and I'm going to find out a new animal. So that's, we just don't know. We don't know. There you go. No one knows. Help us, Mia.
I have got a question that's come through on Instagram, which is, Russell, what is your favorite animal?
What is my favorite animal? So I've got three favorite ocean creatures. One I love so much, I had it put on me forever. So I love, there it is, octopuses. Octopuses are my top favorite. My second favorite are sperm whales, because they're so loud. They're the loudest animal. They're so loud that when they shout, they can be heard anywhere on Earth. That is so cool. They've also got the biggest brains. And the third one that I like is a tiny, tiny plankton called mesodinium, which no one's ever heard of. But it's basically, it's halfway between a plant and an animal, like a planimal. And it's and it has like a ballerina tutu that it flaps up and down, and it swims by flapping its tutu.
Oh, there we go. That
is pretty cool.
That is very, very cool. Annette, quickly, do you have a favorite marine animal that comes to mind?
Oh gosh, it's really, really hard. I think I also love the sperm whale and the octopus as well, but there's too many. I don't think I can pick one. I really love orcas, because they're so smart. So they've got the second biggest brain in the world, and they have whole cultures. So depending on where you live, if you're an orca, then you'll have a different kind of accent when you talk to other orcas, and you'll have different things that you like to do for fun, different things that you'll eat. Like, they're really like humans in the way they have their own culture and society. So
amazing. I don't need to say mine, because you've both said octopus and orca, and they're up there with my favorites. Sure. So Kylie Stevenson, how big can a manta ray grow?
So it's from Henry. Well, Henry, I've just got to say, Henry, manta rays are awesome, because look what I've got on my other arm. I've got a manta ray, because those are also one of my favorite animals. Now, the thing is, Henry, I know that you're six, and that's the key That is the number that you've got to remember about manta rays, because they are 6 meters from tip to tip of their wings, which is like three tall people wide. So you could, if you were like King Neptune, you could like stand on one and be, manta ray, take me somewhere. But manta rays have got the biggest brains of any fish, I believe. So they're super clever as well. There we go.
But only stand on them if you're King Neptune.
Yeah, don't stand on them normally, because they don't like that. They're like, no, leave me alone. It stops them from flying. Right.
Have we got time for a couple more questions?
I think
we'll just keep going.
More, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, excellent. Okay.
Let's
so
just keep going. We can run over. Let's keep going.
Question from Rebecca on Facebook Messenger. How many leatherback turtles are there in the world? Oh, so, Evelyn, 9 from Nottingham. Hi, Evelyn.
So not as many as there should be is the answer, but there's over 100,000 in the wild. Well, no, there were 100,000, but there's about 20 or 30,000 females left. We don't know exact numbers because we're not able to track all of them, but we've lost most of them since 1980, so they need more protection. So I think there's around 36,000.
Listed as endangered, aren't they?
They are.
List endangered species.
So the big problems with turtles is because they like eating jellyfish, and you want to think what looks quite like a jellyfish in the water, it's plastic bags.
Yeah.
So what happens is there's a plastic bag floating around and the turtle's like, oh, this looks like a nice yummy jellyfish, comes in to eat it and ends up eating the plastic bag, which makes it get really poorly. The other thing that really hurts turtles is when something called ghost nets. And this is when a fisherman accidentally loses their nets over the side of their boat. And then the nets, even though they don't belong to anyone anymore, they still float around and they still keep on catching animals. And a lot of sea turtles end up getting tangled up in old fishing gear. So we need to make sure that the fishermen are careful with their nets when they do things.
And if we all work together, we can make sure that there are more of them, which is better for everybody.
So from Noah, Bailey and Phoebe in St. Ives. Hi, guys. We have hundreds of moon jellyfish washing up on our beaches at the moment. We have tried putting some back into the sea, but how long do they survive out of the water before it's too late? Oh, great effort, guys. And that's great that you're going down. And we've actually, a couple of weeks ago in our news feature, we reported that there were quite a few strandings, weren't there, of moon jellyfish. Personally, I would say the best thing to do is to reach out to your local marine conservation group. They will definitely know the best sort of action to take, and they might know a bit more about the reasons why they're ending up on your beach. Mm-hmm. Obviously, be very, very careful. But I don't know if Annette or Russell have anything else to comment, but I would definitely reach out to your group, because you know they might have projects running and they might have groups that are going out, and you could do it as a bigger group as well. It's a great way to meet people.
So one of the problems that we've got at the moment in the ocean is that we're catching lots of the big fish that eat things. And what happens is this, if you think about like a food chain that you learn about at school. So normally at school, you learn about a food chain where you get a plant which gets eaten by maybe like a rabbit, and then that rabbit might get eaten by a fox. But in the sea, you might have a different type of food chain where you might have something like a piece of plankton, which is a little plant, gets eaten by a bigger zooplankton, which gets eaten by a bigger fish, which gets eaten by a bigger fish. But what happens if we come along, we catch some of those fish, then all of a sudden the jellyfish are like, nothing's eating me anymore. I'm going to grow really quickly. Nothing's eating me. And then we end up in a situation where we get all the jellyfish are like, let's grow. Nothing's eating us. Nothing's eating us. So if there were more turtles around, then they would be eating the jellyfish more. And then we wouldn't have so many jellyfish washing up on the beaches.
That's right.
There we go.
Brilliant answer.
It's all linked together.
It is all linked. Okay, God, we've got so many questions coming in. Bear with me a second. Okay. How many babies can a seahorse have, and how deep is the deepest part of the ocean?
Oh, whoa. And they're from East London. That's where I live. Yeah. Hi, Silas and Nora. Bow massive. Right. Someone else do the seahorse one. Okay, I don't know that
so
one.
So it's males who carry their babies in seahorses, which is really, really cool. They carry them in a special pouch in the tummy, and they release hundreds of tiny little babies. So lots is the answer. They release, because they're quite vulnerable, they make lots and lots of little babies rather than spending lots of energy on, you know, one or two big ones like we do. So they release lots of hundreds of tiny baby seahorses into the water.
Oh, brilliant.
And the deep, and the deepest part of the ocean is what I talked about in my video, which was the Mariana Trench, or sometimes it's called the Marianas Trench, and it's over in the Pacific, and there's a point in there called the Challenger Deep, and that is almost 11,000 meters underwater.
Wow.
So to give you an idea, so that is deeper than Mount Everest is high. So Mount Everest, wow, I think is about 8,000 meters high, maybe a little bit more. Whereas the Mariana Trench is 11,000 meters deep. So it's super deep. There's no seahorses down there. It's too deep for them.
All right, this is a lovely question from Azara, age 6, Nottingham. How did you start working with the sea? Annette, you go.
So I always loved the ocean since I was, when I was your age, basically. I loved it. And I started training as a vet initially, and then I realized that my heart wasn't quite in what I was doing. I loved it, but it wasn't what my soul wanted to do, you know? And I was like, you know what? I love the ocean. I'm going to follow my dream from when I was 6 of going to be a marine biologist. So I went to university to study that at Bangor in North Wales. And then from there, that's how I got into it.
Amazing.
So really.
So I didn't know what I wanted to do when I was 6. My favorite job in all the world, I wanted to work in the dump, right? And even now I love going to the dump. I'm like, the dump is the coolest place. So I was like, the dump is where I want to work. And then gradually I was like, even when I was like a teenager, I was like, I don't know what I want to do, but I was okay at maths. So I was like, so I started doing art, and then I was like, I don't really like, and then I saw a sign on the tube and it said, we've only explored 2% of our ocean. And I thought, I like the ocean. That means, hold on, wait a sec. Does that mean that over half of our planet, we don't know what's there? There's got to be a job in there. So I went to university in Southampton and I studied oceanography. And now here I am in my room talking to people about the sea, which is pretty cool. So the important thing to do is to follow your heart and do what you love, and it'll all come together.
It will. And there are so many ways that you can go about it. So I wanted to study marine biology, but I also wasn't entirely sure. So I didn't. Instead, I sort of worked and I started volunteering with various ocean groups and Incredible Ocean sort of becoming one. And then I got into I wanted to study animal behavior because I was really interested in the dynamic, basically how and what motivates animals to behave in a certain way, but also their relationship with humans. So there's so many different angles, and the ocean has so many different opportunities for you. There are, you know, and we talk to a range of people. You don't necessarily have to be a scientist or a marine biologist. There are so many different jobs out there. And depending on what your sort of passions are, your skills are. So don't worry if you get to a point you think, I don't know exactly what I want to do. It will come to you. That brings us nicely here from LC7. What do you need to study to become a marine biologist?
So you can study marine biology, but that's not the only thing. There's so many different things that you can study.
So I got to say, so at school, what you need to be really good at, so marine biology and studying the ocean, you need to kind of concentrate on lots of things. So first of all, you need to be really good at science. Okay. So you need to be good at the biology, which is studying the life. You need to know a little bit about the chemistry, which is the chemicals in the ocean. You need to know a little bit about the physics. So the physics are like the forces in the ocean. So Annette looks at the biology stuff, whereas I look more at the physics kind of stuff. But there's other things that will really help you to be a marine biologist. So maths is a really, really useful one, because you're a scientist and you need to work things out. Sometimes you need to make some graphs and things like that. And you need to write and tell people about it. So you need to be quite good at English and writing stuff as well. So you've got to be kind of good at lots of little bits. And then being good at art and things like that is always useful because it helps you be more creative with science as well. So there's that. So that is a really good question, Elsie. Thank you very much for that one.
And being creative is super important because we need more creative people to help us solve all the problems in conserving the ocean. So if you're not, if you don't feel like you're that good at science, don't worry, because it's passion and it's creative thinking and it's like trying hard that matters the most.
Yeah,
exactly.
Brilliant. This is a lovely question. What is the, oh, and such a lovely profile picture. What is the smallest sea creature from Charlie?
Well, this is funny. So this is what I study, Charlie. I study plankton. Now, plankton are plants and animals that are so small. So if you imagine how thick one of your hairs is, some of them are smaller than one of your hairs. I haven't got any hair. I should do like more of my beard hairs. So these plankton, teeny tiny, but then these plankton also living in the sea, we have got bacteria plankton that float around in the sea, and we've even got viruses that live in the sea. And now we don't have to worry about getting them as humans because these viruses like to go into plankton cells. But basically the smallest creature, like animals, they're about the same thickness as a human hair, so teeny tiny. And lots of sea creatures start off small as tiny babies and then they grow bigger and bigger and bigger. So
excellent.
Good question. Great. I like that.
Thank
question.
You. Very good question. Okay. Another one for you, Russell, I think. Do any animals live in the Mariana Trench? If so, which one? Thanks, Jasmine.
Well, it's a really good question, Jasmine. So this is really interesting. So there's loads of animals. And when we started studying the deep ocean, like 200 years ago, 100 years ago, all the scientists were like, there won't be anything living in the deep ocean. It's far too deep and so much water squishing them that there will be nothing. And then gradually we started discovering more and more and more things that live in the deep sea. So in the Mariana Trench, even down at that depth, there's things called snailfish, there's things called ratfish, mm-hmm. and there's even like sea cucumbers. But what was really scary that they found, the last time they went down into the Mariana Trench, which was only last year, they were looking around and the guy, he's called Victor Vescovo, he looked out of a porthole and he saw something that absolutely terrified him. And what he saw at the bottom of the Mariana Trench was a plastic bag. Even at the deepest point in the ocean, we have got plastic bags now. So we need to sort out our plastic, don't we? There we go. But thank you very much, Jasmine.
Very good. And that I saw one, which, here we go. Talking of plastic bags, what can we do to help save the oceans? Florence, that is a fantastic question. So there are lots of little things that we can do, which collectively will make such a difference. So being really mindful of our rubbish, so not to litter, making sure that if we can recycle items, that they do get recycled. Trying to think about our waste. So if we can, you know, buy, shop locally, use as little sort of single-use plastic as possible. But taking an interest in your ocean is a big, big one. So by taking an interest and finding out lots of information about the ocean will give you the knowledge that you sort of you need, and you can talk about it and you can speak to your friends about the ocean and all the animals that you love. That's the best. That's a really lovely way to help your ocean.
And if you're eating anything from the ocean, then make sure if you can that it's been caught sustainably, because some ways of catching fish hurt the ocean way more than others. So if you can think about that when you're buying fish in the supermarket or your local shops, then that will really help as well.
And my way, so one of the biggest things that is really harming our ocean, and it's a really weird idea, but basically, if you eat less meat and have less milk and less cheese, that actually helps our ocean, which is a really strange idea. But because we have so many cows, millions and millions of cows everywhere on Earth, all of these cows are pooping all the time. They're making so much poo And then this poo gets washed into our rivers and goes out into the sea, and it creates giant oxygen dead zones. And all those cows are constantly burping and farting and giving off gases that cause climate change. So if we all had less cow in our life, if we all had ate less beef, if we had less milk and we had less cheese, the ocean would be in a much better state, which is a really strange idea. There we go.
Brilliant. Okay. Brilliant. I mean, the questions are still coming. These are fantastic questions.
And also, don't worry if we don't get round to your question. We're going to go through all of the comments, answering all of them after the show, any ones that don't get answered. So don't worry.
And maybe follow us on Facebook, and we just so that in case, like Annette said, we will go through them and answer them all.
So many questions.
How many sets of teeth do sharks have? Matthew, brilliant question.
So sharks produce teeth all the way through their lives. So exactly how many teeth they have in their mouth depends on the species, but they have three rows of them that grow constantly like a conveyor belt. So they kind of start off inside it and like grow outwards. So sharks always have teeth in their mouth. So something like a great white shark has about 300 teeth in their mouth at one time. And it basically, the way that they grow in three rows, makes sure that they have sharp, strong teeth all the time. Something like a Greenland shark, which is really slow and not so much of a predator, more of a scavenger, they only have about 50 teeth in their mouth. So it really depends on the species.
Awesome. Cool. I love sharks.
Yeah, super cool.
And this is a really good question. Does coronavirus affect sea animals? Brilliant question, Charlotte.
So this is interesting. So there are a lot of scientists that study whale snot. And people are like, what? Whale snot? So basically, when a whale comes to the surface and they go and they blow out, lots of little bits of snot come out there. So what scientists do is they get a drone with a little dish in it and they fly it through the whale blow and they catch all the viruses and stuff that land in it. So, and there are occasions where people have been out whale watching and they have actually caught colds and the flu from whales. So that is possible. But as at the moment, we have seen certain animals like tigers can get coronavirus, I know. But I don't think people have researched it, unfortunately. But I imagine, if depending on how close they are to tigers, so maybe things like seals and manatees and maybe even whales and dolphins might be able to get coronavirus. But no one studied that yet, Charlotte. That is a really good question because it could impact them. Who knows?
Who knows? And on a conservation approach or aspect, I suppose a positive way of looking about it is that human activity has, you know, ceased a bit. So the seas are a bit calmer. Fisheries and big corporate fishing companies have eased up their operations, which means there's less traffic in the ocean. So there's less noise pollution. But it also means that the wildlife is sort of having a bit of a chance to, you know, freely roam the oceans without quite as much disruption from human activity. So if there is positive effect, it is perhaps that the wildlife has a bit more space and a bit more freedom to sort of do as it normally would. Okay.
Good answer.
Abigail, woo, lovely name. Why does the coral reef have an ecosystem? So, lovely question.
It's a lovely question. So everything in the world has an ecosystem. That's kind of like lots of different animals and organisms that all live together and function as part of one thing. So a coral reef has an ecosystem because it's got lots of different creatures living in it, from the coral to the bacteria to the fish to the bigger animals. And that's what makes it up.
Awesome.
Good question. And I like, even though Abigail is only five, she's still using the word ecosystem, which is awesome. Clearly, Abigail is set for good things.
Naturally, it's in the name. okay, let's go. Why? This is a nice question. From Molly, why does the sea go in and out?
Well, this is really cool. So the sea, so if you're talking about waves, so the waves are caused by wind going over the top of them. So, and gradually it kind of pulls the water along, and then that wave keeps going till it gets to the coast, and then it breaks, and then it goes and pulls back. But if you're talking about the tides, so the tides are caused by the gravity from the moon and from the sun that actually pull the water in different directions. And this tidal wave that happens can get amplified. So I don't know if you've ever done this, Molly, but I do this sometimes and I get told off. Is I sit in the bath and then I rock backwards and forwards, and then I get just the right time, and then all the water in the bath sloshes over the edge, all over the floor, and my housemates are like, why have you done that? And I'm like, I was just doing an experiment. But this is basically what happens to the world as well. And so in different places around the world, we get much bigger tides. So actually the second largest tide in the world is in the Bristol Channel in the Severn Estuary, where 14 meters of tide water goes up and down twice a day. Whereas in the Mediterranean, the tide is only about 2 meters, maybe not even that in some places. So the tide does change quite a lot. And so this is why you need to be good at physics to figure out what the waves and the gravity and all the forces are doing, so you can predict what the tides are going to do.
So I would add, if you're going to rock backwards and forwards in your bathtub, it's better not to slosh the water over the edge.
It's true. You'll get told off. You'll get told off.
We don't want anyone getting told off.
No.
I love this question. Joshua, what creature is the fastest in the sea?
So it depends, doesn't it? So me and Russell have had this, well, all of us have had this conversation before, because there's some things that swim really fast, like a marlin or a mako shark, and they can go over 40 miles an hour. They can go really, really fast. But there are some tiny things in the sea that travel really fast that Russell can tell you about.
So earlier I told you about my favorite plankton called mesodinium, right? So it's tiny, and it's like two little balls on top of each other with like a tutu around the middle. And even though it is the same thickness as a human hair, when something tries to eat it, it flaps its tutu and it can jump 1.5 centimeters in a second. So imagine that you're tiny, you're so small that you're the thickness of a hair, and then all of a sudden you can jump that far. So that's like the equivalent of us being able to see an aeroplane flying overhead and then just jump up off the ground, high five someone in the plane, and then land again. So for me, that's quite fast. But yeah, it's a big creature that swims around. I think mako sharks or tuna fish. Tuna fish are super fast as well.
Very fast. Yeah. Oh, brilliant. Cool. Evelyn from Nottingham wants to know, do small fish have bogies?
Good question.
Fish don't breathe through their noses like us. They breathe through their gills. So they wouldn't have snot in their noses to catch kind of bacteria and different things, but they would, they do have kind of like a mucus membrane layer in their gills.
Great question.
But things like whales and dolphins, they would get bogies. They get bogies. Yeah. But luckily they don't have fingers and they can't reach up onto their blowhole to pick their nose to get their bogies out. So there we go. Good question. I like that, Evelyn.
Very good question. Now, why do shark attacks happen? This is a really good question.
Ooh, really good. I'll let Annette do this.
So basically it's because we're in the wrong place. It's not the sharks. So sharks always live in the ocean. And they don't actually really like eating people. We don't taste good to them. We're not the prey that they want to eat, because they need to eat stuff that's really high in fat, because they basically choose where they are in the water, how much they float, their buoyancy, by using a really big fatty liver. So they, when they eat something like a seal or a small whale that's really, really blubbery and fatty, that's great for them. We're not really that fat really for them. So it's an accident. And normally it's because humans are going in the ocean in areas where sharks live. And if we're wearing like a wetsuit and we look kind of black, or we've got something, you know, like a surfboard with us, it makes us look like seals and things. So it's really a case of mistaken identity. Mm. And we're much more dangerous for sharks than they are for us.
So I
just to put this into perspective, right, Jennifer, last year only two people died from shark attacks from two people in the whole of the year in the whole world out of it, right? And if I say to you, how many sharks did we kill last year? And people are always like, I don't know, like 10, maybe 50. How many sharks did we kill last year? Last year, we killed 240 million sharks. So to give you an idea, that is three sharks we killed every second. And like I was talking about before, about if we catch or kill all the fish, then we get loads of jellyfish and all the ecosystem goes out of sync. If we get rid of all the sharks, which are the main top predators in the ocean, then our ocean ecosystem could collapse. So what we don't need to worry about is shark attacks. What we do need to worry about is us killing and catching too many sharks.
Yeah.
Great. That's far more dangerous.
And great question. Thank you for asking that question, Jennifer. Why do pufferfish have spikes?
For protection. So lots of fish in the ocean get eaten by other fish. Okay, so what these guys do is they're really venomous, which means that they have poison inside, like toxins inside those spikes. So if you touch them, then they can inject that into you to skip, like to stop you eating them, basically. So it's to keep them safe in the ocean.
Excellent. Excellent. Ooh. Yeah. Okay, so we have got a message.
So we got 4 minutes left. So let's bish bash through these.
Yeah.
I want to try and get as many done.
We will answer the rest in the comments. So
we will. So there is a message here from all the year two children at Gateway School. Hi, guys.
Hi.
They're watching.
Year two at Gateway.
Watching live with their teacher in Google Meet. Hello. Right. We've got a few questions, so I will we'll bash through them. What is the biggest jellyfish in the world?
Ooh.
Lion's mane jellyfish. It can weigh up to 2 tons and it can be up to 80 meters long with all of its tentacles.
Wow.
Bam! Just wow. Google lion's mane jellyfish and you'll be like, what? I cannot believe a jellyfish is that big! But it is. Lion's mane jellyfish, very big.
Brilliant. What is the most poisonous sea creature?
Ooh,
I think it could be the Portuguese man of war.
I think you're right. I think that is.
I don't think it is.
Ooh.
I think it's the Australian blue-ringed octopus. And that is a tiny little octopus that lives in rock pools around Australia. And it has got bacteria that live in its mouth. And if you get bitten by this octopus, it injects you with a neurotoxin that stops your brain from communicating with your heart and lungs. So you end up drowning in your own body. Right.
What?
There's no cure for this. The only way to survive a bite by it is if you get bitten next to someone that really likes you and they're prepared to do CPR and mouth-to-mouth resuscitation on you for 4 hours until the neurotoxin wears off.
Wow. I think you were right, Russell. That does sound like the most.
And how many types of shark are there?
Oh, I think we have about 300 species of shark.
Again, we're discovering new ones all the time. And the main way that people find new species of shark now is going to fish markets. And they're like, this is weird. Why is this weird shark here? This shouldn't be in a fish market. And it's only because a scientist has gone and they've managed to find a new shark. But we've discovered a lot of new sharks by going to fish markets.
So you could discover more?
Yeah, definitely.
How odd is... was the oldest animal?
Ooh, so I know the answer to this. So our oldest living vertebrate, which is something with a backbone, is the Greenland shark. So we don't know exactly how old the oldest one is because kind of being able to age their tissues is something that we're still kind of learning how to do super, super well. So some people think that they might be as old as 512 years old, but some people think it's more like 490. But that's really old.
That is ridiculous.
Really good question. Thanks, Jasmine.
Right, I'm just going to do one last question, and I think it's a nice question to end on. Oh, wait, no, it's the wrong one. But we'll answer that one anyway. Why do sharks have pointy fins?
To help them swim faster. because it makes them more hydro, more able to cut through the water, basically, so that it kind of makes the water flow past them. It helps with the friction from the water.
Excellent. A shark is basically like an aeroplane. An aeroplane's have pointy wings to cut through the air. A shark is like an aeroplane in the water and it tries to go as quick as it can.
Beautiful. And last question, because I think it's a good one. Why is the ocean called the ocean? Rosanna, age 8.
Huh? Whoa. That's an awesome question. I'll be honest. So what's interesting is obviously it's only called the ocean in our language, but it's called other things in other different languages. But I'll be honest, I have absolutely no idea, Rosanna, and I am going to research this afterwards. And this is why it's so much fun doing this, because I have no idea why it's called the ocean.
But this is why we need creative minds, because if you're asking questions like that now, maybe you'll ask important questions when you're older that could help us save our ocean.
Absolutely. Exactly. And it's just a perfect example that you always keep learning, right? So we can go away now and we will go and look into this.
So thanks to you, Rosanna, you've made us find something out, something new out. So you are awesome. Like, you can go away and be like, I asked those guys a question that they didn't know. So yeah, good work, Rosanna. You are awesome.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone. They were such incredible questions. And we've got so many more to answer, which we will spend some time going through these today. And you will see our reply. But thank you all so much for checking in, for telling us where you're from. It's been a pleasure.
And subscribe to our YouTube channel. And you'll get loads more stuff like this.
Yeah.
You are all incredible. Our next episode is on Wednesday, if you want to check that out.
Yeah, Wednesday at 6 o'clock. So check it out. Through our YouTube channel. Right, we'll play the outro. Bye, everyone. Wonderful. Thank you so much.
Have a lovely day.
Bye.
Incredible ocean. Magical place to be. So much that we can learn from life in the deep blue sea. Incredible ocean. Magical place to be. So much that we can learn from life in the deep blue sea.